Good morning. This is Father Scott Liana from St. Thomas of Canterbury Episcopal Church in Greendale. Joining together with me in prayer this morning is our parish deacon, the Reverend March Kiss, and our parish senior warden, it's a little bit like the chair of our church board, Ms. Margaret Doan. And we welcome you to this time of shared praise and fellowship remotely, wherever you may find yourselves right now. As we begin to enter into our prayer together, I'd like to invite us to pause for just a moment and let's bring to God whatever is happening in our hearts or in our lives at this time, whatever it is that we are thinking about, praying about, pondering in our hearts. We'll take just a brief moment of quiet and then we'll continue with our prayer. For those of you familiar with Episcopal prayer, our prayer will continue in the Book of Common Prayer, should you happen to have one at home, on page 355, just like it does every Sunday when we gather here. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father. Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, keep your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread, that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour. Knead it and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There, in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah will have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure? The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son. But Sarah denied, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. He said, oh, yes, you did laugh. The Lord dealt with Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son, whom Sarah bore him. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Now Sarah said, God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me. And she said, who would have ever said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 116, verse 1, and then verses 10 through 17. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication, because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I called upon him. How shall I repay the Lord for all the good things he has done for me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds. I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem, hallelujah. Our second reading is a reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to his grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that sufferings produce endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news, the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In this morning's Gospel reading, Jesus chooses his disciples, entrusting a very challenging ministry to them, that of proclaiming and living the kingdom of God. I want to just repeat briefly part of the Gospel passage that Deacon Marge just read. Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out, to cure every disease and every sickness. And these are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip, Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. Now, recently archaeologists have discovered a little-known memo was sent to Jesus shortly before he chose those 12 apostles, but I was fortunate enough to get a copy, and I want to share that with you today. It's from Jordan Management Consultants in Jerusalem. They were a firm operating in the first century. And this was written to Jesus. Dear sir, thank you for submitting the resumes of the 12 men you have picked for management positions in your new organization. All of them have now taken our battery of tests. We have not only run the results through our computer, but also arranged personal interviews for each of them with our psychologist and vocational aptitude consultant. Profiles of all the tests are included, and you'll want to study each of them carefully. As part of our service and for your guidance, we make some general comments, much as an auditor will include some general statements. This is given as a result of staff consultation and comes without any additional fee. It is the staff opinion that most of your nominees are lacking in background, education, and vocational aptitude for the type of enterprise you're undertaking. They do not have the team concept. We recommend that you would continue your search for persons of experience in managerial ability and proven capability. Simon Peter is emotionally unstable and given to fits of temper. Andrew has absolutely no qualities of leadership. Two brothers, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, place personal interest above company loyalty. Thomas demonstrates a questioning attitude that would tend to undermine morale. We feel it is our duty to tell you that Matthew has been blacklisted by the Greater Jerusalem Better Business Bureau. James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus definitely have radical leanings, and they both registered a high score in the area of impulsivity. One of the candidates, however, shows great potential. He's a man of ability and resourcefulness, meets people well, has a keen business mind, and has contacts in high places. He's highly motivated, ambitious, and responsible. So we recommend Judas Iscariot as your controller and right-hand man. All the other profiles are included and self-explanatory. We wish you every success in your new venture. Sincerely, Gamaliel, son of Tolmai, Jordan Management Consultants. Now, that's kind of a fun preface to a book on discipleship. And the fact that really, the simple report is, brothers and sisters, from today's gospel, Jesus chose very real, very human people. People like you and me. And as scripture unfolds, and as we see Jesus interacting with these apostles, with his followers, we too may start to wonder if he made really good choices or not. It seems like they constantly are not quite understanding, not quite getting it. And one of the passages, one of the meanings of this passage is that very real, very flawed, very regular people are entrusted with the kingdom of God. And we might even back up to the first reading that Margaret proclaimed this morning from Genesis, and we see again two very real, very flawed people willing to take a leap of faith, and they in turn are entrusted with the kingdom of God. So, real people seem to be what Jesus entrusts the care of his work and his mission and his ministry to. It doesn't seem to be so much about picking the brightest or the best. It seems to be about choosing people who are real, who are who they are. And in a sense, I think that's kind of heartening for the likes of you and certainly for me. We see real people doing real work right now, I think, in so many ways in the common life that we share. On a local level, a national level, even an international level, as very real people from every conceivable situation, background, and way of life are coming together and raising up for us a simple truth, that Black Lives Matter, that racism is a sin, is a stain on the life that we share together, and that together we, as very real, very flawed people, are trying to do what we can to speak a word of justice, to try to usher in a time of healing, and to simply say collectively, because we are entrusted with the ministry of reconciliation as members of the church, we are better than this. And so together we are in a time right now that is praying for and working for transformation. Not with all the perfect people, but just with all the people, whoever they are. And there's flaws that are a part of this, certainly, and there's a great deal of brokenness and pain. There is violence that is a part of this right now in our shared reality. But together, there is a message of hope, a message of new life. And that is being carried out, and that message is being entrusted to the likes of you and me and everyone else. We're living in the midst of a pandemic right now, and again, we see very real people stepping forward in all kinds of ways to check on, to love their neighbors, to offer themselves in service, in working for a cure, in caring for those who are ill, in reaching out to grieving loved ones who have lost somebody to COVID-19. We see people coming together in society in all kinds of ways, trying to struggle and trying to do what is right to not share this virus in the event that they may be carrying it and not even aware of it. We see people reaching out and loving neighbor in all kinds of ways in very ordinary, in very real circumstances and situations. You see, Jesus entrusts his kingdom and the work of his kingdom to people, to regular people like you and me. I want to lift up for us this morning just a couple of examples of some very real people who in some way in their own lives were entrusted with the care and the keeping of the kingdom of God. They might not have seen it that way necessarily, but certainly they were doing God's will and God's work in their lives. The first one I met when I was 20 years old, and I showed up for my very first AA meeting at Marquette University. It was a student meeting. And I walked into that thing, I was shaking, I was sweating, I was a mess. And there's these other students sitting around this table, and then there's this one very old guy who just wouldn't quit talking. His name was Tom Hubble, he explained to us. And Tom was there as somebody in recovery who was helping us to learn about this new life, about working the 12 steps. As I got to know Tom, I began to realize that he really took turns having all of us over to his apartment and feeding us and trying to encourage us. And I remember the first time he invited me over, he gave me his address. It was on 18th Street and Wisconsin Avenue. It was a very small studio apartment. And as I walked in, he spread his arms open wide and he said, "Can you believe all of this is mine?" And he was so grateful. And we sat at the card table that was his kitchen table. He had prepared dinner for us and he shared with me how grateful he was to be living this new life of recovery. His previous address, he told me, was Brady Street, just Brady Street. That's where he lived. He talked about his years in serving our country in the military and just some of the mental illness and some of the pain and brokenness that was a result of that time when he returned and how he could not put his life together. And now here he was. He'd been given something beautiful and fragile, the gift of hope and sobriety. And this man was sharing this gift with the likes of me, giving us hope, giving us the idea that new life was possible for us too. Tom was about as flawed and broken as they come, and yet he did the work of the kingdom of God. And just the other day, I was blessed to have an internment service for my best friend's mom. Doris lived one day short of her 88th birthday. She was a biological mom and an adoptive mom, worked as an emergency room nurse for her entire career, and was a woman of deep and profound faith. And we reflected together when we got together to thank God for her life on just all the ways that her faith touched the lives of so many and the lives of those in her family, and the hundreds upon hundreds, if not thousands of people that she brought care and comfort and healing to during her work as a nurse. She too was entrusted with the care of the kingdom of God in her regular and ordinary life, and in return gave God a beautiful and a profound gift. So brothers and sisters, one of the major tasks of the spiritual path is to figure out who we are and whose we are. And as we grow and grow more into the discovery of whose we are, we realize that we are those entrusted with the care, the mission, and the ministry of the kingdom of God. And so the question is, how will we respond to that invitation? How will we accept the gift of faith that is ours and work to share that faith with those in our lives and those all around us? Because like those very first apostles, you and I are entrusted with the care of the kingdom of God. We may think God has a good sense of humor, but that's how God works. And so I invite you in these coming days to spend a little bit of time in prayer and reflection on how it is that you are living the message of the kingdom of God, and how it is that you are being that living example of the faith that has been given to us and the blessings and gifts that are given to us in abundance. Let us too then be living examples and messages of the kingdom of God. Amen. If you have a Book of Common Prayer at home, we are going to continue now in the words of the Nicene Creed. It's on page 358 in the prayer book. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
This morning, for our prayers of the people, we will be using Form 3, found on page 387. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us also pray for our own needs and those of others.
Let us pray this morning for victims of injustice everywhere. Let us pray this morning for police officers. Let us pray this morning for those affected by the pandemic in which we live at this time. We give grateful praise this morning for those in our parish community celebrating birthdays or anniversaries. And we pray that God would continue to watch over and bless our parish community, St. Thomas of Canterbury. Almighty and ever-living God, we bring you our prayers and our needs, those we have spoken, and the prayers that all of us keep here inside of our own hearts. Accept them, we offer them with faith and with trust, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray together now for the coming of God's kingdom as Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We have a few parish announcements. Starting tomorrow, Monday, June 15th, we will begin our study of the Holy Spirit. So far, 18 parishioners have signed up, and so that's what we'll be moving forward with. And that will be a great opportunity for us to spend some time with God's Word. By now, you will have received a letter from me, the parish staff, and the vestry about worship moving forward. And so if you have any questions about that, don't hesitate to contact us. We continue to offer morning prayer, evening prayer, and noontime prayer every week via Zoom. And also, our plan is to continue with this kind of a Sunday morning schedule moving forward, where I will offer a good morning and a greeting at 9:30, and then we will have this celebration of prayer at 10 a.m. put on Facebook and YouTube, and then we'll gather electronically for coffee hour via Zoom at 11 a.m. May God continue to bless, watch over, and guide you. And now may the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and God's Son, Jesus Christ. And may God bless us all in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.